Cool. Hello, guys. We'll be starting up in just a couple of minutes. I hope you're having a good day. Hey guys, great to see you. We're going to be starting in just a moment. Hello, how's it going? Nice to see you. Oh, how are we doing today? I'm feeling pretty good. I've just I run two of these sessions every morning, and it's really nice to see you guys. I've just been running my Key Stage 1 and 2 session, and I had everyone going rap, rap, rap by the end of it. So I'm being a bit fried. But it's really nice to see you. I think we've got more people popping on. We're gonna have maybe a more civilized event. Please don't just start going rap, rap, rap at me. I can read you a piece to start maybe as we start out. Hello, if I've not met you before, my name's Mark. I've got kind of a weird job. I'm a poet, and I'm I do some rap stuff as well, and I kind of write stories. And I used to be an English teacher for 5 years. I was a secondary school English teacher, and for the last 10 years, I visited lots of schools, and I spent a lot of time writing things and putting them on YouTube, trying to get things to go viral, and kind of popping around and doing stuff like that. But I love working with people, and I miss teaching a lot. So these sessions are really about me saying hello. You can do some cool stuff with words whilst we're all locked down, and hopefully I can guide you through a few things that will be useful. And if nothing else, at the end of this session, which should be about 40 minutes, probably, unless everyone starts like typing loads of like crazy requests, you should have got like some really cool ideas down, and you should have done some really good writing for the day. So the only things you're going to need is a pen and a piece of paper. Okay, no worries at all. Thank you very much. Someone's just said they're in school today, so they can't take part. That's absolutely fine. Anyone who is welcome to join in later, you might be watching this right now and not watching it live, so that's totally cool as well. I'm really pleased you guys are enjoying them. That's really, really nice. Oh, lovely. That's wonderful. So you can see that you can comment in the side as we're going through things. I'll give you guys I can give you guys a bit of a poem or something to start with, if you like. I can tell you about my dog, Boo. Is that all right? I might start with that. Just because she went missing the other day, not the other day, but like about a year ago, she got out of our gate, and she went missing, and we were really scared and worried about her. Her name is Boo. She's a pug. So she's a bit funny looking. She's like super cute and very friendly. And we were very worried that we might never see her again. And we were very scared. And we spent 3 days traveling, you know, like going all around the city with posters and everything. And loads of people shared pictures of her. And it was a terrible time. Really, really stressed out. But we couldn't believe how much people helped us. And then 3 days after she'd gone, we got a phone call saying that someone had her. And we got her back, which is like amazing. And we couldn't believe it. We were so lucky. And I went down the street where I live actually, and was taking down posters. We have a lot of people within our street who have moved from different countries. And I was chatting to a guy, and he couldn't really speak any English. He could only speak Polish, and I couldn't speak any Polish. And he was going, "Is your dog okay?" And I was like, "Yeah, we got her back." And like, I started crying, and he started crying, and he gave me a hug. And I feel very proud to live where I live here in Peterborough, because we have a lot of people that look out for each other, even if we don't always speak the same language as each other. So very lucky to get her back. So this is a poem about her, if that's all right. Her name's Boo, a lot of people tell me when I have a pug that that's not a proper dog, right? And I don't know. Perhaps they're right. When it came the time to choose a dog, she wasn't what I had in mind. I thought I'd get a massive dog that stomped with great big loping strides. I thought at least I'd get something that seems a little dog-like, not all squashed up, wheezing, frog-like with an ugly mug that's cross-eyed. When it came the time to choose a dog, I thought a pug is just the wrong type. For a start, I checked online. There's tons of sites that say a pug is not a proper dog. There's a range of reasons given because of overzealous breeding. Pugs have problems with their breathing. They're pretty much always sneezing. And apart from objects here and here, they struggle just to see things. So for that and tons of reasons, I figured pugs were off the table. Until we went to see one. And she was pretty cute. So we did something pretty stupid, right? We called her Boo, took her home. She's now my dog. I've been pleased to note that she is capable of doggy things. I've witnessed her both lick and sniff. The dining room has lots of stains from all the time she's weeding it. She farts and poos and nibbles things. She chews her way through everything. She sleeps most days and her snoring grates. She even snores when she's awake. It's like the noise I think Darth Vader would make if he ran every leg of a relay race. I'm the first to say that she's pretty strange, but I also think she's pretty great. And I took her out the other day to the local pub where everybody loves her. And one by one, the regulars all make a massive fuss of her. And she's wagging to the point that her bum could nearly wander off until one guy at the bar, he shouts over, starts mouthing off, "Oi mate, that ain't a proper dog. That's a rat you've got. Be careful you don't trip on it." I hear that every now and then. And every time I grin a bit, because it's exactly the same routine that follows, right? She'll wag and she'll run up to his chair and he'll scowl from high above her, say her form isn't proper, till eventually he starts fussing her and then he's totally in love with her. And I don't care about his opinion or that he changes his perspective. What I care about and what I love is I think Boo is really quite impressive. All right, so her bark is more of a cough. She's lopsided when she walks. She can't really fetch a stick unless the stick is really small. And he doesn't even know about her fear of basketballs. What's proper great about my dog is she doesn't care at all, right? She's happy and she's loving and she thinks that she is great. And I know that there's been times that I didn't feel the same because I've been in a lot of places where people have said that I'm not a proper poet. And it hurt a bit. I stopped producing work as if they found my art's Achilles. But since Boo's arrived, I'm like, forget those guys. The labels all seem silly because, yeah, proper poets and proper dogs. I've pictured it. I don't want it much. It reeks of class, not of love. Just lonely labels, stuffy stuff that's really dull and cumbersome. It's all right for some, just not us. We're Boo and Mark, poet and dog. Perhaps we're not the proper ones, but you can't deny that we poo and we write in the same field as all the other ones, so I'm dead happy with my puppy. There's no way that I'd swap her just because someone says that there are dogs that are more proper. I don't want another version. She's something I take delight in. And if I ever met a proper person, I don't think that I'd like them. Cool. Thank you very much. You're very, very kind. That is my poem about Boo. Now, what I'm going to do, I wasn't even going to read that at the start, but that's a nice way of starting us off, right? Like, we kind of have a bit of a story and a poem. And you know what? I will, if you like, I'll go and fetch her. While you're doing the first bit of writing, the first little task we're going to try today, I'll go and pick her up. Now, today, we're looking at storytelling. And we're going to be trying to write our own stories about a trip. Deep underneath the waves. Now, today we're going to look at three different things I just wanted to talk to you about. Oh, that's lovely. Thank you so much, guys. I really enjoyed performing for you all. That is all about... Oh, what pub did I go to? Oh, gosh. Daniel McGinley. Yes, all right. The pub, it was Charters here in Peterborough. Gosh, I cannot wait to get to... the pub and have a lemonade in a few weeks. But yes, we can absolutely see Boo. We've got somebody asking that 100%. I will bring her up and you can check her out in a second. Here's what we're gonna look at. We're gonna go on a journey today. We're gonna try and write a few things, but we're gonna look at something really key today. We're gonna look at foreshadowing and how important foreshadowing is in story. If it's a term you've not heard before, do not worry. We're going to go over three types of foreshadowing today so that by the end you'll be an expert on how foreshadowing works. I'm going to put in a bonus restraint as we do a little bit of writing to see how like clever you are at kind of solving a little bit of a puzzle. And we're going to try and come up with a cliffhanger ending for our pieces of writing. Now, for this session, you're going to need to have some a pen, a piece of paper. If you're feeling anxious or worried about what you're writing, please, I understand that. Sometimes I feel anxious or worried about what I'm writing, but I will guide you through everything. It will be fine. And the main thing to think about is not to worry about being perfect. I think fear and worrying about getting something wrong is what stops us being creative. And so we're going to try and put that to one side. So this session is called like a trip to Atlantis, journey to Atlantis. I can show you my... my phenomenal, I made a special slide for it, but my printer ink ran out partway through. But Atlantis, under the ocean, going all the way down underneath the ocean to Atlantis. And we're going to try and write about that. In order to do this, your task, first of all, before we start anything else, to get us thinking about going underwater, I'd like you to write 10 words you associate with the word water. It could be any words at all. So 10 words that you think of, and I need you to put those words somewhere in one group, and we're going to kind of like come back to those words partway through the session. So any 10 words you can associate with the word water, I should go and fetch Boo. I'll be back in just 1 minute. Okay, so we should be at the point where we've got kind of 10 words. There we go. How's it going? This is Boo. There you go. Is that all right? There you go. That is Boo. She's enjoying the sun today. She's been lying outside in the sun. She's quite enjoying you quite enjoy the lights, don't you? You quite like it. Okay, well, that is Boo. She likes to lick. That's kind of her main hobby. So let's take her down. There we go. Good girl. Let's pick you out. Well done. Well done. Yeah, it's been really lovely having Boo to walk every day during this period of time. So hopefully we've all got our words. She knows it as well. Someone just said she's beautiful. Yeah, well, she definitely knows it, I think. So we're going to be writing our own stories today, and we've got our 10 words, hopefully, that you have gathered for this story. Now, this story, we're not going to use those words straight away. We'll come back to those. But I'm going to kind of challenge you as we're writing, as we're going through this. But this story, I think with foreshadowing, what's important? Foreshadowing is when in a story, we start to hint at the things that are going to happen later on in the story. Okay, so foreshadowing is when something happens or there are images or ideas and they're kind of suggesting what's going to happen later on in the story. They're starting to give an idea of where things are going to go. And in order for short foreshadowing to work, I think we often need to know where we are going to go at the end. Close resemblance between me and Boo, very much so. So where are we going to end this story? Now, today we're going to get to the point where you are underwater and you are being attacked by a sea monster. I'm very sorry to tell you guys this. That is where we are heading. All right. You are going to be underwater in your own kind of submarine and you're going to be attacked by a sea monster. That's where we're going to end up. Maybe you successfully fight it off. Maybe you don't. You're cool. I do not mind. But I think knowing that that is where we're going to go with this story, I think will help us to bring in some of these ideas. So the very first thing we're going to need to do, everyone, you are going to need to come up with, we're going to come up with our own little submarines that we're making. We're going to go underwater in them. What shall we name our deep sea vessel for our exploration, our journey to Atlantis? You have spent, if you can imagine, you've spent many, many days and weeks hammering away, building this. I've got a nice example here of a potential sea vessel, but yours can be completely different. It's up to you. But what do you picture when I say you're going to go underwater in a sea vessel? What's the shape of it? What does it look like? What's it made of? And this is the key thing, what do we name our sea vessel? What shall we call it? Okay, what are we going to call the vehicle that we are going to travel underneath the ocean all the way down into the depths? The Nautilus is a very famous deep sea vessel from literature. But what could you come up with for your own sea vessel? I'm going to give you like 30 seconds to decide on the name for your underwater sea vessel. Nice. Okay, we've got our first suggestion. Atlantic 1.0. Ooh. Very nice. I like that. That's a really good suggestion for our sea vessel. I think mine might be have the word boo in it somewhere. I'll be like the... the Pug Marine. Pug Marine. That's mine is. I'm going down the Pug Marine. Atlantis, nice. Gypsy, the Great Blue Depths. Amazing. So we've got our names for our sea vessel. Now it's useful to think of a name, I think. I think it's a good starting point to think of a name for our vessel. But where this is really going to come alive is when we start to think about describing this sea vessel from the outside. Okay? So this challenge here, and for a lot of these challenges, the target is going to be to write 6 lines maximum. Okay, now whenever I try and do writing exercises with people, I think 6 lines maximum is a really good target. When I'm saying that, you might go, what? you want me to write 6 lines? No, no, that's the maximum. That's the most. If you write 2 lines, 2 sentences, 4 sentences, that's totally fine. Pirates down under. Yeah, crab. Do you know what? I'm totally on board with Crab Rave Vessel. I think that is a great name. Love it. Oceanic Explorer. Great. I do feel like Crab Rave Vessel is a kind of like maybe a populist vote has gone for that. It's kind of the boaty boat base, but I fully would get on board with Crab Rave Vessel. That sounds like a right laugh. So we've got our ideas, but can you describe your deep sea vessel from the outside? And so I want you to put the name of your sea vessel into this sentence. We lower, and then the name of the vessel into the water. And then the next sentence I would start with either, because we often talk about sea vessels with the pronoun she, right? That her or she. So I would say we lower pirates down under into the water. She, and then carry on. And I want you to give me 6 lines maximum describing how this vessel looks. What does it look like? And standing by the water, does it smell? It smells quite tricky, but is there any way you can bring smell in? Maybe the sea, there might be something you can get from with smell in relation to the sea. What about touch? Is there some way you can use touch as a sense? The more we use these senses in our writing, descriptive writing, the more powerful the description is going to be. And can you get a simile in? Oh, if there's some way to get a simile into the writing, brilliant. Now, we're not worrying about the foreshadowing at this exact point. We might do some foreshadowing by accident, just, and we'll find out that, because we'll do a little foreshadowing check after this. But for now, I just want you to, all I want you to worry about is describing your sea vessel from the outside. We write, we lower, and then the ship into the water, and then her or she, and then carry that on for 6 lines. If you want to change that up, you can go with something else, but that's the target. 6 lines describing, try and get all these things. And I want to feel like you are there, standing on the edge of a jetty or a dock, or on the side of a big boat, looking down at this deep sea vessel that you've got. Okay, I'm going to give you, not long. I'm going to give you 3 minutes. See how you do. And I remember, 6 sentences maximum. Okay, remember, we don't just have to focus just on the sea vessel. We might have some other things around us if we're stuck for other ideas. Maybe there are some some wildlife. Maybe there's noise of the sea around you. How can you get something that? Oh, we got some lovely stuff popping up on the thread already. That's great. You don't have to worry about putting things on the thread. If you want to just write them on paper, that's totally cool. Lovely. I'm just reading these. This is fantastic. Okay, that's a good 3 minutes. So, how did we find that? Okay, now that was a very tight piece of descriptive writing. We were trying to find a way of making us feel like we were really there. I like it. What have we got? So what we got? We lower Poseidon's vessel into the water. My Lord, was she a beauty. I really like that line. My Lord. It's a great exclamation, that, isn't it? It shows that it's taking your breath away and you're so impressed with it. Beautifully crafted in a cylinder shape. Lovely. Really, really nice control of the description. I can really picture what's coming up there. I can't show the rest of the line because there's loads of lines in that, but that's a really nice one. I like this little bit here. We got as quick as lightning. The Atlantic 1.0 sank to the depths of the dark ocean. All right, cool. We're already sinking in this piece. That's great. That's totally cool. I'm really happy if you're still already going under, but you don't have to be. So we've got our kind of the... Oh, someone else has put it up. Yes. Crab ray vessel. Ready to go. We lower the crab ray vessel into the water. Maybe this should be a race to Atlantis between all of our ships. My teeth chattering in curiosity. Oh, I love that. That's nice. She descends into the deep, translucent sea. You can't read the next sentence on this video bit here, but it does say the hatch creaks open and I hurry inside. I really like that for two reasons. Creaks open. I love the creaks, the onomatopoeia, and that we're using the sounds. That means we can really picture ourselves being there. It kind of brings the reader in more. But also, I think the hurry inside is very clever because you're showing me that you're very excited and you're very eager. But you haven't just said, I feel excited, which is very easy to just say. You've shown me that rather than told me that through the actions. Okay, it's very clever. So I really like that. All right, cool. So we've got all those ideas. This is great. Now, we might by now have started to include some foreshadowing, because some things foreshadowing wise are very concrete. The two types we're going to talk about now, we'll do the last one at the end, but the two, one is kind of concrete foreshadowing. And concrete foreshadowing is just whenever you mention something that we can see, like a concrete object or an item that is going to come up later in the story. Now, foreshadowing is always when we're showing things prior to them appearing later in a major way in our plot. It's annoying, I think, if you're watching a film or a TV series and there's a massive problem and you don't know how they're going to get out of it. And then someone just pulls a thing out of their pocket randomly, like a gun, just shoots up the thing, it's dealt with, it's sorted. What I think is disappointing about that is we're just surprised by it. We haven't seen the gun previously, so there's no, it kind of destroys any kind of sense of tension or excitement. What's really effective is if we were to see that gun earlier on in the story, and then we've registered that the gun is there somehow. So when the person pulls out the gun and deals with the problem, actually, we're not that surprised by it, but we are kind of, because we didn't fully remember it, but it's been foreshadowed earlier in the story as being something that could come up. Now, foreshadowing happens loads. If you ever watch like a spy thriller, like a Mission Impossible or like James Bond, there'll be that whole bit, won't there, when they go and get their gadgets and one by one they go through all the gadgets. And that's really obvious foreshadowing, because one by one we go through all these concrete items that are going to be used. Now, the term that's used a lot in writing for this is a Chekhov's gun, okay? Because there's a play, Uncle Vanya, by Chekhov, where a gun appears. And there's this idea that if a gun, particularly, is going to appear somewhere, the gun has to be used. You know, we have to use it somewhere for it to have a purpose. So what we might already have in your descriptions is we might have some Chekhov's guns. We might have some features that are going to come in later on. For example, we've got a hatch that creaks open that you climbed into, haven't we? Now, that hatch is kind of a Chekhov's gun, because I can forget about that, but I will always remember there is a hatch on this submarine, right? You've done some really clever foreshadowing there. And if you ever do mention the hatch again, because you've mentioned it beforehand, as a reader, I'm totally on board with that. Like, that feels really smooth and really, it feels quite rewarding for a reader whenever we kind of call back to the things that have been foreshadowed. So have a look at your own writing. Maybe you've got some Chekhov's guns in there, some items so far. For example, I even showed you my picture had some claws on it, right? Maybe if your ship, if you mentioned claws, great. Well, those claws, that could be a Chekhov's gun, because maybe they're going to be useful later on. Now, there's another type of foreshadowing, which is symbolic. This is much more subtle and more complex, but sometimes you might have symbolic events take place that could suggest the events that are going to come later. This often happens, it can be quite melodramatic, often it can happen with the weather. Imagine everyone's having a lovely time, you're having dinner, and everyone's going, oh, this is lovely today, and then suddenly like dark clouds appear overhead. That would be symbolic foreshadowing for that. Also have foreshadowing because a character does something early on, and that they do the same thing later on. For example, maybe a boy jumps off a cliff and his friends say, oh no, don't do that, that could be dangerous, and that could be the start of your story. Well, actually, maybe that same boy will be too impetuous later on somehow, or perhaps actually a really good story of Mice and Men has got some really good symbolic foreshadowing early on in the novel, where one of the characters has a mouse that they've squashed, unfortunately, within their hands. I don't want to give away the plot of Mice and Men, but that happens right at the beginning. It turns out they were too strong and they couldn't control their strength. And there's very clear foreshadowing there for the events that are taking place later on. So that's foreshadowing. It's really, really important. What we're going to do, we might have accidentally done it, but we're going to try and attempt to do a bit of foreshadowing now for our sea voyage. Now, remember, things are going to get Lenny. Oh, bless him. I love him. So things are going to get pretty bad, right? We're going to get attacked by a sea monster. I've even worn my special squid t-shirt, my giant squid t-shirt in preparation. So when we go inside our vessel, we're going to describe the inside now. Now, inside, I want this to be pretty nice, right? Inside your sea ship, it's going to be pretty luxurious. Some of the things you might have, I think you probably would have. You'd probably have sea charts. You'll have books. You'll have paintings. You'll have framed newspaper clippings of other expeditions that have gone down to try to go there. You might have tropical marine life in a fish tank that's swimming around, and you might have a porthole looking out onto the horizon that can look out and can see the clouds and the weather outside of you. Now, I want you to write a descriptive piece of writing where you describe the inside, the interior of your deep sea ship as you prepare to submerge. Now, some of you have already gone under. That's totally cool. You're already under. That's great. Just have a look around the ship as you're there. I want you to start this by saying inside, and then the name of your ship, I. And then talk about everything you can see and hear. What can you hear inside the ship as you start to go down? I bet it's noisy. Maybe there's clanks and there's sounds and things. Maybe there's things you can see. And I think some of these things, there might be a chance for foreshadowing. Is there any way you could start to suggest, as you're describing, even just slightly, that either symbolically something might go wrong, or maybe there are some Chekhov's guns, maybe there are some items you could mention that could be useful later on when you're attacked. So your challenge, once again, is for 6 lines maximum. You're going to start with inside the name of your vessel, I, and then tell me what you can see and hear using all those senses, but see if you can, within it, maybe there's something wrong inside the fish tank. Maybe you just notice something unusual that could be representative of what will happen later on. Maybe something could happen with the sea charts. 3 minutes, see how you do. Remember about the senses. If you've started to use things you can see, maybe we can get a sound in. Maybe we can get, maybe there's a smell. Maybe there's something you're cooking inside your submarine. Ooh, lovely. We're getting some cool ideas so far. I really like this. Pressure of the water bashed on the side of my vessel, causing me to fall over. I like that. So we know that pressure could be something that could come in later to your story, don't we? We foreshadowed that the water pressure could be interesting. We've also got the sound of the whales. You've mentioned whales in there. Maybe they're going to be useful later in your story. Maybe there's some way the whales are going to come in later on. Doing really well. We're going to have another 40 seconds on this. So don't worry, as much as you can get. And you don't have to post them up. You don't worry about that. If you do, that's great, but you do not have to. Just, this is about you kind of seeing what you can get down. See how you can do. But yeah, some cool ones I'm seeing so far. Lovely, Emma. Really nice. Genius, absolute genius, brilliant. Don't worry, keep on going, keep on working on it. If you're still working on your ideas, getting them down, this is great. Okay, so we've started now to think as we're talking about it. We know where we're going to go, right? It's really clever. If we've thought about where the story's going to end up, we can be foreshadowing, we can put in these ideas in. A really nice example that we've seen inside Atlantis. I'm looking around and I see an escape hatch surrounded with sea charts, bookshelves crammed full. Nice. So we've got an escape hatch there. That's a really good example of a concrete foreshadowing, bit of Chekhov's gun that we've got in there. We've got, I configure the omniscope while I slowly get down from the ladder. So we know there's a ladder where fish swim around. I'll read the rest of this because we can't put it up on the screen. My fish swim around in the tank adjacent to me as if they had seen the devil himself. Oh, that's quite symbolic, isn't it? Something's going to happen in relation to something. That film makes me feel something like bad is going to happen. Maybe you're bad. I don't know. Maybe you're going to change in this story somehow. Or maybe this, you're going to have a choice where you could harm the creatures down here somehow or not. That's going to be your decision to make. Those are the things that I start to think we could be foreshadowing. Great. Lovely, lovely, lovely. Now, if we're bringing it right into an end there. Hopefully, that's been a really good chance for us to have a go, right, at kind of coming up with some Chekhov's guns and some more symbolic foreshadowing as well. Now we are going to dive deeper, all right? Now, just to let you know, congratulations, you are halfway through all of the writing in this session. You're doing really, really well, by the way. Our next stage, we are going to start, and it's going to be 6 lines maximum. Once again, I'm going to give you 3 minutes. And all I'm going to say here, right, is I want you, we don't worry about this monster yet, everything's fine, but we dive deeper. And I want you now to look outside of your submarine. You're looking out and you're going to describe all the things that you can see in the water around you. But I'm going to give you a bit of added pressure in this, a bit of a challenge. I want you to describe and talk about everything you see and everything that's going on as you go deeper and deeper and deeper. I'd like, perhaps there's something glowing down at the bottom of the sea, maybe. But what are there? We've already had whales. What else could there be? What can you hear? How are you feeling? What's happening to your body as you're going down? Are your hair standing on end? Are you excited? What's happening to all the other things around you? But I would like you to focus on those things. And as you are looking out, here's your challenge. You are not, in your six lines, allowed to use any of your 10 water words from now on. At the start of this workshop, you wrote down 10 words to do with water. You're not allowed to use any of those words when you're describing what you can see outside of your submarine. I know, that's really mean, isn't it? That's really mean. But this is a restraint that we're going to add to ourselves. And I think this is going to force us to maybe be a little bit more original and think of some different language. So that's your challenge. Six lines maximum, 3 minutes. What can you see? Once you've seen this, things can be pretty sweet and pretty happy, if you like, because after this, the monsters come in. So what can you see? What can you hear? What's going on as you're going down? And you cannot use those 10 words if you put them down to do with water at the beginning. Off we go. This is really mean, isn't it? You can do it. You can definitely do it. I'm sure you can. Well, then, what is there going on? How can you get your lines down without using those 10 words? John, I like the fact you've got guns in a cabinet. That's a really good, I mean, that's about as Chekhov's gun as you can get, right? But I like the fact that you've mentioned you don't quite know how they work or what they do. So we've also flagged a real problem that the hero is going to have. Take up 20 seconds to just start kind of seeing where that leads. Well done. How did you find that? How was it? Maybe that wasn't too hard. Maybe you didn't have words that were that essential to you. But I think sometimes applying a little restraint, if we're thinking about going into an environment or we're writing about a certain location or a certain thing, sometimes I'll try and write the first words that come to mind to do with that thing. And I'll put them to one side and I'll think, maybe I'll try and not use those, but I'll try and think of some other words or other language to use. Because anytime that we're pushing ourselves like that, we're being more original, aren't we? And that is really fundamentally what we're always looking for. That's the kind of the holy grail of writing, is to kind of have original ideas. So we started to get some ideas. Emma, you're crushing it today. Well done. This is lovely. We dive deeper into the great unknown, full of secrets just waiting to be discovered. Marine life flourishing in their homes and families. This is a pure form of beauty. We venture further on our adventures. Lovely. Everything's going cool. Emma is great. Nothing's going to go wrong, I'm sure. We've got John. We dive deeper, plunged into darkness. We turn on the lights around the vessel. I can see mysterious creatures circling. My head starts to spin as I watch them. These are great. These are really, really good. Cool. So we've got all our things. We've done our task where we've kind of managed to avoid those words. Everything, for some people, everything's going pretty well. Something is, Jimmy's, yours has gone bad pretty quick, hasn't it, Jimmy? That is cool, though. An eerie shadow in the distance glided towards me, making a howling noise. A school of fish rushed past me. Lovely, rushing past me with a terrifying expression on their face. Bang! Something hits my ship. So Jimmy is like jumping straight into the drama there. Fantastic, really well put together. So everyone, here we go then. Suddenly, this is it. It's kicking off. It's going horribly wrong. I want to see if you can do six lines maximum on this. And guys, this is where we really need to amp up the fear, the terror, the unknown. What is your sea creature? If you're stuck, I'm always a big fan of the giant squid, all right? Because you've got tentacles that can be kind of like attaching themselves, that can be pulling at the ship. Maybe there's like a huge eye here that can appear. That was really, really intimidating. Maybe you can't even see it fully yet. You don't know what's going on, but there's just a shadow. What's going to happen? But this is where things are going to go badly. And this is where we're now going to start bringing our foreshadowing in. If you've got ominous foreshadowing, now we're going to really start to bring it out. I'm going to give you 3 minutes, six lines, see what you can get. That's it. We're nearly over the finish line. This is the last bit of writing you're going to do with me in this session. So come on, let's get it. Let's get as much down as we can. And then we'll see what we've got. These are so good. These are really, really impressive. Everyone who's writing on these, what I'm seeing, this is phenomenal writing. Really impressed. One minute left. That's it. Let's get this over the line. This needs to be really bad. Things need to be going really, really, really out of control. Maybe you've started to solve it, but it's not okay. Things are getting really, really terrible. Thank you. Okay, time is up. Wow. Wow. So impressed. All right, that is a real workout. I'm hoping you're really feeling the brain power that was required to kind of put all that together. You've really kind of gone full tilt on it. Well done, particularly anyone who is key stage player. I think we've got some adults popping on here every now and then as well. Sometimes, so you guys are keeping up with some serious tense writing. Let's have a look at what we've got. So we've got the monsters start to make a terrifying appearance. A tentacle grabbed my ship, followed by another and another. I like the another and another. They're really, really nice. We've got suddenly the pure essence of the marine life vanishes. Every oceanic creature swimming hurriedly in different directions. That's fantastic. Then we see it. I like a short sentence for impact. That's great. A shadow so large it could be the length of two buses. Nice. I ordered my crew to prepare the turbo rockets and spears in case this goes south. Oh, I like it. You're like, yeah, you're geared up for this. Suddenly 18 gypsy, this is great. Suddenly 18 red eyes flash in front of me. It is the Hydra. No, the Hydra, the nine-headed beast of the Greek legend. It is dragon shaped and starts bashing the ship around. Oh, okay. Amazing. Right, guys, you have done brilliantly today. All right, you've done so well. Your final task, and I want you to go away and do this after I've said goodbye, is this. Give yourself kind of like 5 minutes, and I want to know, what are you gonna do? How are you gonna get out of this problem? Give yourself 5 minutes to try and write an ending to this chapter of this story. Does it work what you do? Is there a bigger problem to end your chapter on at the end of this? Now, as you're trying to solve this problem, let's bear in mind our foreshadowing. Have you got any Chekhov's guns in your ship? Have you, the submarine, is there anything you've got? Can be as obvious or as secret as you can think of, but are there any Chekhov's guns that you've got around that are concrete that you can use to solve this problem? The good news as well, if you solve this problem and you don't use any of those items, then they turn into the third type of foreshadowing, which is a red herring. Now, red herrings, it's a term where people used to smoke herrings. They became really smelly, and people used to use red herrings to draw scent off for if dogs were chasing things or people. They'd often use red herrings to kind of mask a scent, or like criminals might use them to kind of mask a scent from any kind of dogs. So a red herring is kind of when we've done some foreshadowing, but it doesn't appear in the story. So you've got some options now. How are you going to end this? Are you going to end it with Chekhov's guns? Is everything you've mentioned going to come into use? Or are some of them not going to be used? And the great news is whatever you don't use becomes a red herring. All right? Didn't end up using it. It wasn't important to the story. So that is our workshop today. You've done brilliantly. You wrote with those restraints, trying not to think about using those words. You're telling a story, using your descriptive writing brilliantly. We use the five senses. We also, and the key thing is the foreshadowing. We've got these three types of foreshadowing. Chekhov's guns, which you're very good at. Symbolic foreshadowing, which we had loads of great stuff on that as well. And then we've got the red herrings, which we might find out by the end of this story. We had one or two red herrings in our story that we didn't end up using. That's the challenge, guys. I have loved working with you guys today. I really have. It's given me a great start to the day, and I'm really impressed with everything you've done. If you do write this fully and you want to share it with me, feel free. Any pictures, send them to mark@markgrist.com. That's my email address. Or send them to me on my Facebook page if you're watching through that. Anything that I get, if you send me pictures of you with your story or writing it or any stories that are finished, I'll send you feedback and I'll share them up on the page. If you don't want it shared, just say you'd rather not have it shared. But you have done brilliantly. You've worked really hard. The final stage now is when this finishes, can you finish it? What do you do? Does it work? Have you got any Chekhov's guns that you can use? Guys, well done. Fantastic work. I will see you next Wednesday when we'll move on. We might do more kind of poetry stuff next Wednesday. I might show you how to kind of like create a really kind of cool spoken word poem. All right. See you later. Bye-bye.